You know that any m times n matrix A can be associated to a linear transformation from Rn to Rm. Now, if your matrix is nice and square diagonalizable, you know how this such a matrix looks geometrically. In essence, the eigenvalues tell you what's going on. But what if your matrix is not even square? In that case, the singular value decomposition will tell you what happens, and in essence, you will see that the singular values determine what happens, as you will learn in this video. So, let's take a look at a singular value decomposition geometrically. So, transformation R from Rn to Rm, Tx equals A times x, and we assume that we have its singular value decomposition u sigma vt already, you know how to make it. And as a domain, we have factors in Rn, and we look to normalized factors. So, we look to factors with norm 1 in the domain. And why do we want that? Well, we want to compare factors. We want to see how much factors are amplified. And we want to compare things which are initially all of the same size. And we want to see in which direction something is growing very big and something is growing very small. So that's why we take initially factors which all have the same length, length 1. So in R2 that will be unit circle, in R3 that will be the unit sphere. And we're going to see what happens to those factors if we apply the matrix A. Now, in essence, as we will see, the sigma is telling the whole story, so we'll focus on the action of sigma matrices first. And start with an easy one. We go from R2 to R2, and we assume Ra is some sigma matrix with singular values sigma 1 and sigma 2. So, what happens then? Our domain will be the unit circle. Then we can compute y equals y1, y2, y equals a times x. You get sigma 1 times x1 and sigma 2 times x2. So, what do we get? If we compute y over sigma 1 and y over sigma 2, we get x1 and x2. Square and add, and then we get y1 over sigma 1 squared plus y2 over sigma 2 squared equals x1 plus x2 squared, which equals 1, so we get y1 over sigma 1 squared plus y2 over sigma 2 squared equals 1. And you recognize this, hopefully, because it's the equation of an ellipse with semi-major axis sigma 1 over there, sigma 2 over here. So the mapping T in this case maps the unit circle to an ellipse. So that's what this sigma is doing. Now let's see if we start with some non-square matrices. So what's if you do, for example, from R2 to R3. Again, the sigma 1, sigma 2 part, and then a row of zeros. What happens in that case? Well, then again, we have y1 equals sigma 1, x1, y2 equals sigma 2, x2, but now sigma y3 equals 0. So again, we will have y1 over sigma 1 squared plus y2 over sigma 2 squared equals 1. So that's just as in the previous example. But now we also have y3 equals 0. So how does that look? Well, in that case we again start with a circle. We again get an ellipse in the y1, y2 plane. But now it's the additional condition that y3 equals 0. So just an ellipse in the plane. So that's what we get in this 3x2 case. Let's look at the next case, 2x3 case, if we have a column of zeros. So we now know what happens if you add some rows of zeros, basically nothing. What happens now if you add a column of zeros, more columns of zeros? Well, then something is happening. Notice that you now have a transformation from R3 to R2. So you start with a unit sphere. What happens with our unit sphere? So we know x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared equals 1. Now, again, we get y1 equals sigma 1 x1 and y2 equals sigma 2 x2. So we have again y1 over sigma 1 squared plus y2 over sigma 2 squared equals x1 squared plus x2 squared. But now this is equal to, you can put the x3 squared to the other side, this is equal to 1 minus x3 squared. And x3 can be anything. So this 1 minus x3 squared can be anything from 1 up till 0. So what do we have over here? This stuff over here is smaller or equal than 1. So our equation tells us y1 over sigma 1 squared plus y2 over sigma 2 squared is now smaller or equal than 1. That means that we don't get just the boundary of the ellipse, but also everything which is inside. So the sphere is now mapped to an ellipse and everything inside in a picture like this. So we start with the unit sphere and it's mapped by t to 2D plane, to an ellipse and all of its interior. So that's what the matrix does. If you also have some columns of zeros, you also map to the interior as well. Now, let's summarize, because till now, everything we did was only with sigma matrices. But what about the U and the V transpose? What are they doing? Well, basically nothing. That's the good story. So actually, the sigma matrix is determining what's going to happen. Look, for example, from right to left. If you have your A equals U times sigma times V transpose. So if you compute A times X, you start with V transpose times X over here. Now, what does V transpose do with your X? Well, your V is an orthogonal matrix, so it's basically rotating axis and so on. But you start with a unit circle or unit sphere. So if you rotate that or maybe reflect it, you still keep your unit circle the same. You keep your unit sphere the same. So the V transpose is basically doing nothing. Now then, after your V transpose has acted, your sigma is acting. Well, you have already seen what the sigma matrix is doing, mapping a circle to an ellipse or a sphere to an interior of an ellipse, something like that. So you know what your sigma is doing. And then finally, your U is coming. So what is your U doing? Now, U is again rotating and reflecting. Okay, now you have an ellipse. So now the rotation is doing something. It's rotating your ellipse, so it's not exactly the same anymore. So instead of an ellipse, you get a rotated ellipse, but still an ellipse. So basically, your U is also doing kind of nothing. So what's the singular value decomposition doing geometrically? The main information is in what your sigma matrix is doing, and the U and the V matrices around it are just rotating axes. So this is how you can view your singular value decomposition geometrically.